Dear friends, welcome once again to the third part of the module on Misconduct in Academics and Research. We start this module by knowing the reasons behind the misconduct in research and education. In order to curb the misconduct, we must first know the reasons that trigger such misconduct. Most of the research scholars do misconduct in the phase of the crucially tagged to the number of research papers credited to an academic's name. There are other elements that are equally crucial to enhance the academic performance index. These include projects, lectures, pedagogical innovations, special resources provided to the students, extension activities, and participation at various forums in various roles. So, if research is not their forte, there are a good number of options still open before them to prove their intellectual mettle. Yes, definitely, they cannot be a zero on the research front. But if they genuinely engage themselves on the listed fronts, it is certain that they would have more authenticity and first-hand experiences to share with the academia. They simply have to be active on other fronts, think and connect the dots. It would be an original, authentic and real value addition to the discipline. If one has the substance put together in a specific context for the linguistic front, one can always seek professional assistance or may simply run the script through a better equipped or reliable colleague. So, when does such misconduct occur? Such misconduct occurs when the researchers or students lack consistency in their efforts. When the researcher or students work in fits and starts, the quality of output would be shoddy and shady. They work under pressure of deadlines and are tempted to take shortcuts. The universities and research institutions are subjected to a performance audit. This is done to ascertain that the institutions are achieving maximum out of the resources employed by them. The researchers and faculty members are ever under pressure to publish more number of articles as their promotions and projects are all linked to the number of publications they have to their credit. In a spree to climb the upper rungs of the career ladder, they resort to malpractices. The reading culture of the students and researchers has dwindled. If the students and researchers don't read a literature of their field, they cannot assimilate, critically think, and generate their own ideas and thoughts. So, they end up copying from already published literature. The students spend too much of time on desktop and laptops, simply hopping from one website to another and downloading the full texts. It has been observed that the students and researchers do not do in-depth reading while they are online. This has been termed as squirreling behavior by the researchers. The libraries have tremendous importance as physical places. The footfalls in libraries have gone very down. All required content is not available online. When the researchers perambulate among the shelves in the libraries, they come across many new books about which they did not know before. That is where they learn new information. This is known as the serendipity of information, as per Macri et al. 2014. The students or researchers indulge in misconduct because they are low on self-confidence. This confidence needs to be built with proper training. Critical thinking and analysis of the things will let the researchers have so much original to write and report. Thus, the menace of plagiarism will be curbed automatically. And The constraint of not knowing a language, particularly English, should be dealt objectively and scientifically. If one is ready to put in efforts, the same can be improved satisfactorily to the desired levels. So, friends, up till now, whatever we have studied in this third part of the module were the different reasons behind such misconduct in either academics or research. Moving ahead, we will now discuss stemming of misconduct in academics and research. To prevent or to curb such misconduct, all the stakeholders play a very, very critical role. Teachers, supervisors, and guides should promote the researchers to do critical and analytical thinking. All the stakeholders need to communicate and infuse in the minds of young researchers the basic values of hard work and honesty. School libraries have the basic responsibility of instilling moral and ethical values in the students during their formative years. The children need to inculcate the habit of reading, which will help them assimilating, synthesizing, and generating their own ideas. University libraries should use their skills of advocacy, spreading awareness, and sensitizing young researchers about the ethical guidelines for authors and reviewers. Ethics curriculum should be incorporated into the MPhil and PhD courses. Awareness sessions about clinical trials, experiments on animals and human subjects should be conducted. Libraries may provide a 4-credit course for research scholars. The course should include the components of ethics in research and use of various softwares, tools, and techniques for data collection, analysis, interpretation, and reporting of the findings. The malpractices may be stemmed if the rules and policies of strict penalty are in place and their enforcement is ensured. The potential perpetrators should know that if they indulge in misconduct, they would be caught and punished. This will completely wash their previously built reputation. Besides, their previous research would be under the scrutiny too. The researchers should be supported to grow and develop their confidence throughout their career. Continuous mentorship and guidance in selecting the right journal for publishing research findings are very important. Some new researchers prefer to get published in spite of knowing about the predatory journals because they want to pad up their CIS, prefer expediency to quality work, and get instant recognition and laurels at their place of work. Maintaining integrity in education and research should not be limited to higher educational institutions. It is a universal concern. The potential of school libraries should be tapped to inculcate honest practices in the school children who will grow to become senior researchers and scientists tomorrow. There should be open acknowledgement and discussion about the errors in research and career failures. Working culture should be built on confidence and not on fear and distrust. The senior researchers should demonstrate leadership by incentivizing juniors for publishing in credible and reputed journals. The authorities should focus on the quality of the research publications and not the number of publications which a researcher has to his credit. The concern should be whether the research is innovative or seminal enough to make an impact on the society or industry and commerce. Alternatively, does it extend the boundaries of theoretical knowledge which exists at present? It has been an accepted practice when talking of the misconduct in research to put the entire focus on plagiarism and ways to check which are usually punitive or preventive. But it is a big paradox that our research sails through all the checks and filters of authenticity and is original, yet does not make any impact. Every researcher's work should be an answer to the challenges of the times and society. The run-of-the-mill research studies are plenty and certainly not required. Research should conjure viable solutions to the challenges of the times. It has to be in sync with the national agenda. It has to be pragmatic and time appropriate. Else, it remains in the confines of academia with no solutions to real world issues. It is all theatrics to pad CVs with no real impact at all. So, dear friends, in a nutshell, to sum up all the three parts of the module on misconduct in academics and research, I must say that we have covered 6 different aspects. They are misconduct in academics and research, different instances of misconduct, UGC policies and policies by other authorships to control the misconduct, detrimental effects of misconduct, reasons behind such misconduct, and the role of stakeholders in controlling the misconduct. So, I really hope that you had a very, very fruitful session in learning different aspects of misconduct while undertaking either education or research. Thank you.